God's reply to a fervent prayer. The book of Habakkuk is an interesting book because it is centered around a well-known question that all of God's people have asked at one time or another. It simply is, why do the wicked flourish and while the godly are oppressed? It seems that the underlying question when we read in the Psalms over in Psalm number 73 is how can a good God allow the righteous to suffer? We've asked this question at one point in our life where we are looking at things that are going on and when we're wondering how can God, a God who claims what we say is good, allow what we call good people to suffer. We're looking at this question. It is a question that has puzzled the saints of God, and yet it pleases those who don't believe. Because they are looking at things that are going on in the life of the believer, and they're laughing at us because it seems like they don't have no trust.
My Lord.
It's an important question that needs an answer. And in order to preserve our faith in the midst of trial.
Yeah.
Too often people think that faith in God comes with a guarantee of freedom from adversity. Somebody has lied to us when they told us that when I accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior, then that means I won't have any more trouble in my life.
Amen.
Somebody has duped you. Somebody has lied to you. Yep. Because coming to Jesus is no guarantee that you won't have adversity.
Preach.
Matter of fact, coming to Jesus does not mean that hellhounds won't be on your trail.
Amen.
Coming to Jesus, all that means is you got a big old X on your back and the devil is going to try to move against you. Too often people think that faith in God comes with a guarantee that I ain't going to have no more trouble in my life. But Job says man is of a few days, and those days are full of trouble.
Yes, sir.
It seems that in many cases, the gospel call is dumbed down, and young converts are made to think that Christ will deliver them from all of their troubles or trials in this life. And when they come to realize that this is not true, that their faith is severely shaken. When Jesus came on earth, he didn't deliver everybody from what they were going through.
Amen.
There were some people on the outskirts of the crowds that didn't get delivered from their leprosy.
Amen.
There were some people in the crowd, and on the outskirts of the crowd, that did not get the help they were looking for. So we need to know that every now and then God will leave you in what you need. The question: why do the wicked flourish while the godly are oppressed, or how can God allow the righteous to suffer? It reveals some fallacies in our thinking and our view of God. Because we wrongly assume that suffering is always evil and thus irreconcilable with God's goodness. Because we are looking at things from a wrong angle. We're looking at God as if, since God is good, how in the world could he allow evil to touch my life. We're looking at this, and we're trying to figure out how is it, if he's so good, how in the world could all these things be happening to me? And when we look at it from this point of view, we start questioning God's goodness.
Right, right.
It's also a failure to understand righteousness as it relates to the true child of God.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus said over in Matthew chapter 6, he said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you." But these things are not going to be added unto you until you first do this. We want to get to the things being added to us before we do what God says.
Right.
In Habakkuk, there is a theme that is structured around two dialogues with one concluding psalm of praise. In chapter 1, the first 11 verses, Habakkuk is voicing his complaint over the sins of God's people, and it seems as if God is indifferent. He's complaining to God, and he's complaining, and then he's mad because it seems to him that God ain't listening.
Right.
Not only does it seem like God is not listening, it seems as if, although he's voicing all of these concerns, it seems like God don't care. Every now and then, our faith is pushed to the limit. We get in our prayer closet, and it seems like God ain't listening.
Right on.
Matter of fact, we know that God has an all-seeing eye. We know that God is watching everything that's going on in our life. But when I pray about the situation, God is silent.
Mm.
We're trying to figure out what is God doing in the midst of my trial.
Right, right.
In our troubling time. In our troubling time, when we fall on bended knee, I'm talking about when all hell has broken loose in your life. When we lose our jobs, but the wicked don't seem to have any trouble. It seems like that when I lose my job, even though the people that are wicked, the people that don't even come to church, they seem to get a new car every 2 years.
Right.
It seems like the wicked, even though when I get sick in my body, it seems like the folk who are wicked never catch a head cold. I'm trying to figure out, God, what are you doing? Why would you allow all this suffering when the wicked, it seems like they're still prospering?
Mm-hmm.
If we are honest, even with ourselves and with God, we get tired of coming to church sometimes, and we start seeing how people who don't even come to church are doing better than we are.
Well.
It may seem like they doing better because they got all the creature comforts that we aspire to. We look at blessings as houses and clothes, right, right, and cars, all these creature comforts, all these tangible things that we can put our hands on, but we never stop to think sometime how God blesses us with sunshine.
Come on now.
How he blessed us to open our eyes this morning when some folk who laid down on last night didn't get up this morning.
Well,
we forget about the things that are intangible, the things that we can't touch, the things that we can't feel. We need to look at God's blessing go beyond the tangible. We want to know at time, where is the Lord in my trouble? Because in our prayer life, We are trying to hold on to God, but our faith sometimes is being stressed. Because faith is hard sometimes, because we know what God can do. And in the midst of knowing what he is able to do, we wonder why come he ain't doing it.
Amen.
Come on.
Mm-hmm.
Keep it real.
We trying to figure out. As I look at the people around me, all the people that are talking about how good God is and how that God is blessing their life, I'm trying to figure out how come God ain't showed up in my trouble.
Well.
Because I got trouble too.
All right. Yeah.
Just because I've been saved, don't mean I don't have trouble. I'm trying to figure out where is God in my trouble. You remember the story over in John chapter 11, I think it is, where Lazarus, his sisters and them told Jesus that the one you love is sick. And Jesus responds to the messenger. He said to tell them, this sickness is not unto death. And he walks back. He takes that journey back to Mary and Martha, and he's got to carry this message to them that Jesus said, the one this sickness is not unto death.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what kind of message that is, because in the text, Lazarus died.
Right.
Lazarus died. It seemed like the worst thing that could have happened, and it's all because Jesus, when he was sent for, he didn't come.
Mm-hmm.
It would seem like Jesus, the one that when he said, the one whom you love, the one whose house you done been in, you done been at my table, eating my food, and how dare you not show up?
Right.
We think that we are Jesus. We got Jesus' ear. We got his ear. We think that sometimes we're the one, we're special.
Right.
As if Jesus got to stop what he's doing to get to us.
Right.
How dare you continue on doing what you was doing while my brother is sick?
Mm.
If you read the text over in John 11, Lazarus died, and by the time Jesus gets to the edge of town, it was Mary and Martha who met him, and they started yelling at Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Amen. And Jesus goes on. He starts moving. When the other one came, said the same thing. All he asked was, where have you laid? Jesus didn't respond to any of the other stuff. All he asked was, where have you laid him? And every now and then, we got to get to the point of where our problem is.
Amen.
Because what we're doing with Jesus is the same thing we do with people. We're going all around what's going on in our life instead of just telling Jesus what we need.
Amen.
We start talking about the weather.
Hmm.
We want to thank you for the sunshine. We start talking about God. I want to thank you that I got food on my table. I want to thank you that I got a place to go and worship. Well, when you're sitting in the hospital and sickness has taken your body, it's not time to be beaten around the bush.
Right.
If you got his attention, tell him what you want.
Amen.
It doesn't seem right when seeking to live godly in Christ Jesus and I still have to suffer. And we want to ask God why he allows so much suffering in our lives. Because we worship and we serve.
Mm-hmm.
I pay my tithes and I pray.
Mm-hmm.
But God, the all-knowing one, he seems silent in the most troubling of times. If you've ever read the book of Job, for 38 chapters, God is silent.
Mm-hmm.
For 38 chapters, Job has this one, he has this monologue. He's talking and he's asking questions, but God ain't saying nothing. But when he gets to when God does finally speak, the Bible said that Job had to put his hand over his mouth. Because now God starts to ask, he starts asking Job some questions. You're trying to figure out when is the all-knowing one who knows all of my troubles? When is he gonna show up in mine? The prophet Habakkuk, he laid out his complaint before God. He cries out to God, and it's a heartfelt complaint.
Amen.
To the Lord. Asking, how long will my prayers go unanswered? He asked the Lord, why isn't he answering his cry for help? And Habakkuk was disturbed by what he saw going on. If you look over in chapter 1, he was disturbed by what he saw, so disturbed that he prayed. Habakkuk showed us that what we don't understand, we can ask God.
Hallelujah.
If you don't understand it, God, he shows us that you can go to God with it. He shows us that you can pray. We can pray and ask God about the thing that you don't understand. And prayer is fervently pouring our whole heart and total being out to God. Let me slide this in because in prayer, there's no sense in trying to hide stuff.
Amen.
There's no sense in praying to God and trying to hide something behind your back. There's no sense in beating around the bush with God. There's no sense of trying to trick God into making him believe that I really believe.
Right.
Because God knows every heart that prays.
Amen. Mm.
And there's no sense in us trying to trick God. He's all-knowing. He knows everything that's going on in our lives. Matter of fact, we are made aware in the New Testament that he knows before we even ask.
Amen.
In prayer, we can thank God and we can make our petitions known. And the Bible says that the effectual, fervent prayers of the righteous avails much. He prayed about it, and since he prayed about it, he got an answer. Hmm. And one of the things about prayer is you can't be afraid to lay it all on the line. God knows that he's aware. He knows the number of hairs on our heads. He is intimately knowledgeable of what we need. So if you got the Lord's attention through the prayer avenue, tell him what you need.
Amen.
What Habakkuk did was pray. He made his complaint known, and then he waited on the Lord to reveal to his will to him. Verse 1, a dilemma for most of us because it's a dilemma for most of us because we don't like to wait.
Amen.
To us, we need an answer right now. But I have learned that sometimes I've learned it painfully. Amen. God will teach us to wait.
Amen.
I don't care who you are. You can't hurry God.
Right.
No, sir.
God is not going to move until he moves.
Amen.
It doesn't matter how long I've been a Christian. It doesn't matter how much I've given in service. It doesn't matter how many times I pray. God is not going to move until he moves.
Amen.
The songwriter said, you can't hurry God.
Right.
You just gotta wait.
You gotta trust him.
And unwillingness to wait on the Lord suggests I don't trust the Lord.
Right on.
And whenever we don't trust the Lord, we will try to do it ourselves. And whenever you get ahead of God, you will always end up wishing you had waited.
Yes.
There's a familiar story over in the book of Genesis. Abraham and Sarah, they were waiting on their child. They were waiting on God to move. God had already said, I will bless you with a child, but they got impatient. And whenever you get impatient and you get ahead of God, you're going to mess up God's plan. They went ahead, and Sarah, she came up with an idea. She said she had this servant. Her name was Hagar. Hagar must look pretty good because Abraham said, okay, I'll do it. She must have looked all right. And so he went in, and he messed up God's plan. Because when at any time you get ahead of God, you're going to mess with things up.
Every time, amen.
The Lord, and unwillingness to wait suggests that I don't trust. And Habakkuk prayed, and the Bible says, and then he waited on the Lord to reveal his will to him. The Lord will respond in his perfect timing. And notice in the text, he stood like a guard, and he waited for God's answer. Habakkuk was not idle, nor was he impatient. He set his heart and his mind to stand watch. He focused his whole existence on listening for the voice of the Lord. Mm. And we learn from this verse, he waited expectantly, and he knew God would answer. He didn't know when, but he knew an answer would come.
Yeah.
How many prayers have you given up on? How many prayers have you stopped waiting on God to answer? He had a purpose in waiting. He waited expectantly because he knew God would answer. In between every prayer and God's answer is a process, and it's in the process we stop believing and give up on God. God heard your prayer, but you couldn't stand the process. Faith is built not just in God answering our prayers, but you need to know that in the process, and if you haven't already prayed about it, if you've already prayed about it, you need to know that you are in the process of waiting. And the devil loves to show up in your process.
Yeah.
The devil will always show up in between the prayer of what I prayed to God and the process and God's answer. He will always show up in the process to try to keep us from believing. Because the devil knows that he can't do anything about what God's going to do. He can't stop God from doing what he's going to do. But what he does is he messes with the believer. He calls us into believing atheists. Because even though I believe God, I act as if God can't do it, as if God is not real anymore. As if God somehow is not able to fix this little problem. Even when I think it's a big problem, it's a gigantic problem in my life, it's small compared to who God is.
Yes, right. Yes.
And here's the best part of the text. Verse 2 said, then the Lord answered me and said, God, he said, write the vision and make it plain on tablets, that he may run who reads it. He had waited a long time, and after his long list of complaints to God, he stood waiting expectantly, and God answers.
Hallelujah.
God's first instruction to Habakkuk was to write down the vision. God reassured him that he was in control of the situation. God's sovereign control should be enough to turn our worry into worship. It should be enough to renew our hope in him. God said, write the vision for all to see. Because it's for an appointed time. Every word that God speaks into your heart and life has an appointed time for its coming to pass. If God said it, I've said before, if God said it, that settles it. It has an appointed time. But the process is similar to a woman who is giving birth to a child. There is the instance of conception because God, that's when God places his dream, his idea, his strategy, and his plan in your heart. And then follows the development where you and the other necessary events are aligned to fit the plan. Then comes the time of birth where the vision becomes a reality. What we need to know is that there is a time of waiting, a passage of time from the time of the vision, that the vision is given to the time that it becomes a reality. It's during this period of time that God enables us to lay the groundwork for our vision to be fulfilled. But we need to be diligent about our immediate work, being confident that God, that the vision will come to pass. During the waiting period, God is bringing everything together that is needed, all people, places, and things that will enable us to fulfill the vision. God made it clear to Habakkuk that his plan for dealing with evil would be revealed in God's time frame and not in Habakkuk's, which means that although God answered his prayer, he still had to wait. And sometimes, church, what happens is God's answer is wait. the recorded vision is for an appointed time, which means that God promises to do something, but we still have to wait. Mm-hmm. And it's best during those waiting periods to write down God's answer, because no matter what happens during the waiting, it may come a point in that waiting period where it doesn't look like God's word is going to come to pass, but you have a recorded answer. And when God says it, that settles it.
Yes.
When God spoke to Noah about building the ark because it was going to rain, all he had to do was build the ark and wait for the rain, because God worked. When God said it, that settled.
Amen.
When God came to Abraham and he told him to leave his country and go to an unknown destination, and God promised him a seed. That word was settled in heaven. It doesn't matter that it took 25 years for what God said to come to pass. All that matters is what God said came to pass.
Amen.
Right.
Whatever God has spoken to you in answered prayer, that word is settled. It's settled already in heaven. It doesn't matter what happens. If God has made you a promise, if God has given you a vision, if God has said it, it doesn't matter how long ago it was. It doesn't matter if the circumstances don't line up with what God said. It's still settled.
Amen.
There's a familiar story over in the book of Acts. In the book of Acts, where the Lord came to Paul, and he told him that you will testify of me in Rome. And some circumstances came about where Paul was getting ready to sail over into Rome, but they came into some trouble. Matter of fact, it talks about the storm that came upon them and tore up their ship. But before all of that took place, he remembered the Lord Lord has spoken to him. And while he was on the ship, the Lord came unto him again and explained to him. He said, be of good courage, Paul. The ship might not make it, but everybody else will. Mm-hmm. And as God said it, the ship fell apart. And those who could swim, the Bible said, they swam the land. But those who couldn't swim, they held on to pieces of the ship. And all I'm trying to tell us today is that when life starts to fall apart, when everything looks like God is not going to bring it to pass, all you got to do is hold on to the pieces of what God says.
Amen. Amen.
Because there's another promise in the Bible which Jesus made, and he said, destroy this temple, and I will raise it up in 3 days.
Yes, sir.
And they thought Jesus was jiving, and they went ahead, and they put him on the cross. But just like he said, when they nailed him to the cross, when Jesus was dying, he made seven statements. The last one is, he talked about commending his spirit to God. And then the Bible says he dropped his head into the locks of his shoulders and he gave up the ghost. Mm-hmm. They didn't kill him. He gave up his life.
Amen.
And since he gave up his life, he was able to raise his life. And what they did was they put Jesus in a borrowed tomb and they rolled a stone in front of it. But Jesus, when he lay in that tomb for the appointed time, 3 days and 3 nights, but on that third appointed morning, what the Bible says is he got up.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
They went to the tomb. They was looking for him. And all they found was his grave clothes and the napkin that was covering his face. The Bible said it was folded neatly by itself. Proof that nobody came in and stole the body, because ain't nobody who comes in and steals the body going to take time to fold up the napkin.
Amen.
Jesus rose just like he said.
Yeah.
Yes, he did.
And he's still with it making promises. And whatever promise God has made to you, don't give up on it. Don't allow the circumstances of this life to make you believe that God's word ain't gonna come true. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna say this last thing and I'm gonna sit down. Over in Genesis, when Noah built the ark, God told him all the dimensions that was needed. It had one door and one window. But the window, it wasn't positioned where I can just look at it, because in order for them to see out, they had to look up.
Amen.
And whenever you look up, your situation is a whole lot better.
Yeah.
Because I'm looking at everything that's going on around me, and I start thinking that this is what God is going to do.
Mm-hmm.
But whenever I focus on God, and I stop looking at everything that's going on around me, I get a different perspective.
Mm-hmm.
All you got to do is look up.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
God.